How does it become a computer? So if I have a box right here, let's see. Right? And I have a keyboard.
Well, that's not gonna be a good angle.
And I have a mouse right here. And I have a monitor right here. All right, all right.
Just want to make sure I cover all my angles.
So, is this a computer?
No.
This a computer?
Yes.
This is the monitor.
Yes.
This is the case for the tower. All right. The CPU, sometimes I question why people refer to the tower as the CPU, because the CPU, this is the CPU right here. It's just one component inside the computer or inside the tower, inside the system. Everything together is the computer. When you bring everything together, this is the computer right here. Okay? I had a friend of mine call me one time and said, hey man, they put a computer out there in the corner of such and such, because when I started working on computers, I would go on eBay, figure out where they were giving away computers, in the free section, if you go to computers. Sometimes, not so much nowadays, but back, you know, 6-7 years ago, people would put computers out on the corner of the street on a regular basis. But my friend called me, said there's a computer in the corner of the street, so I drove down there where he told me, and the only thing that was there was a monitor. And it wasn't, you know, flat screens nowadays are pretty popular, but he was just a big, you know, tank, right? A CRT monitor. And I said, well, where's the computer, right? it's just a monitor. So this is the monitor, this is the tower or the case, this is the keyboard, that's the mouse. When you put everything together, that's the computer. You see that? That's the computer right there. And the computer has four basic functions. What are the four basic functions of the computer?
Input, storage, process, output.
Oh, you guys got all the answers, don't you? This is not gonna work. Yeah, let's try this different one. I'm gonna need a camera person.
All right, so the computer does four things, right? Input, these are the four functions. Output, or before I say that, I know it's not too classy, but. I'm gonna say input, process, storage, and output. Four basic functions. In essence, the computer does four basic things. No matter what we talk about in this class in the next 18 weeks, we're gonna be talking about some component of these four items, right? How does the computer allow you, the user, to put information into the computer? Or how does it allow input into itself? How does it do that? It does that by using peripherals or devices that connect to the computer. One of the main components that is used to put information into the computer is the keyboard. So the keyboard is referred to as an input device because it is utilized to put information into the computer. So it's an input device. One of the devices that is used to, that the computer uses or the system uses to put information out and communicate with you is the monitor. So the monitor is an output device. The keyboard It's an input device. What is the mouse? It's an input device, right? Because we use it to put information into the computer. When you're moving the mouse and you're clicking, you are putting information into the computer to tell the computer to do something. And then what you see on your screen is part of the output. What other component is an input device?
Keypad.
Yeah.
A webcam,
a
camera.
A webcam, all right. What else?
A scanner.
A scanner, all right.
The microphone.
A microphone. Anything else?
Fingerprint scanner.
We'll do scanners. How about that?
Reader?
A what reader?
A card reader, you know, you put a card in there to be
identified
to use them.
Right, so a card reader. You put like which card? Which type of card?
Like your access card.
Your SD card or access card, as if you're going into, right, I get it. But card readers are also referred to as, such as your cards from your cameras, digital cameras. So in essence, this could be an input and an output in an output device as well, because you can also save information on there. What else is an output device?
Printer.
A printer? What else?
Speakers.
Modem.
Wait, hold on. The USB? Okay.
That can be both?
All right, let me create another category. I'm gonna call it I.O. I.O. is input and output, all right? There are some devices that perform both things. They are used for inputting and they are also used for outputting. So, USB is just an interface, all right? USB is just an interface. Because we can have a USB keyboard, all right? I could say that a USB interface allows for input and output, right, of the computer system. Because I can connect a printer could be using a USB device.
Thumb drive. So we'll call it USB storage or something?
Well, a thumb drive would be more in the storage, right? Or hard drive is used to store information, you see? I'm gonna say CD-ROM or DVDs are used for storage, right? And then devices for processing, CPU, random access memory, and other internal components, so the motherboard. Somebody said modem. A modem would be an I/O device, or a network interface card would be an I/O device, because it is used to put information out into the network and also to receive information from the network, right? So it would be an I/O device. Anything else we're missing from here? Output devices, input devices. So that all the devices that connect to the computers we refer to as peripherals. And these devices are used to put information into the computer, and once it's inside the system, we're going to process the information in order to provide an output, or process the information in order to store it somewhere. Bryce, did you have a question?
I was going to say an output projector.
A projector, very good. Yeah. Those are output devices. We need to understand these categories here accordingly, so that we have a clear understanding of what we're talking about when we're referring to a particular device. Hold on a second. Question, by yes.
First one is storage.
Storage thumb drive or flash drive will work. Did you have a question?
I had a question. Is a video card considered to be a processor?
A video card would be part of, it does a little bit of processing, but in essence, it's part of the output device. But yes, because video cards nowadays contain their own central processing units and their own RAM, in essence. So, so part of the processing for video takes place in the video card itself. Yes.
And the NIC?
It's a NIC. This is a network interface card.
Network interface.
Right, it's the card that allows you to connect to the network. And we'll talk about those disconnectors in a minute. Questions or comments on this? It's okay, right? This class is so easy.
No. most network interface cards these days are integrated into the motherboard, aren't they?
Right, but that doesn't mean that it does some processing there. It's still a NIC, right? Modems, you know, were embedded into or integrated into the motherboard as well at some point.
So would the a router be an IO?
Well, a router is a computer in itself. Okay, routers and switches are computers that are designed specially to process data at the network level. All right. So I want you to think of a router or a switch as a computer.
Isaias, wouldn't that also be an IO device, a router?
Well, a router contains IO device. A router is a computer in itself, right? It's a system in itself. It has its own motherboard. It has its own, you know, CPU, its own RAM. Okay, its own network interface cards and its own integrated software that allows it to do what it does. Okay,
as well as external drive.
An external drive would be part of the storage device, right? So if you have an external hard drive, that would be part of the storage. So we have internal hard drives that are inside computers, which is where you store all your information, and then you have devices that are peripherals. Anything that you connect to the computer that's not integrated on the board itself would be a peripheral device. So in essence, what happens is that if we're looking at that board, the board has connectors on the side that we're gonna discuss later. But if this is my keyboard right here, my keyboard connects to my board, okay? If I have a mouse, my mouse connects to that board. And then what happens is that the motherboard has different components that connect to each other. In this fashion. All right. And then this is my video per se. Try to explain this. So this component, when you click on the mouse right here, okay, it sends the information using electricity into the computer or into the motherboard, that green integrated circuitry that we saw a minute ago. And there's a this device, because it's an IO device, is connected to this device And so is this right here, so that they are all connected using traces or lines that allow electricity to travel from one place to another. And then this device processes the information or looks at the information and it sends it to this device using the lines or traces. And then this device sends it to this device, this device sends it to this device. This is the CPU or this component that I showed you a minute ago. Oh, here it is. This right here. So this sits right here. Just like that. Okay? And this is random access memory. So it's just like that. You see that? Once the information is processed, it goes back down this bus, and then it's placed in random access memory right here. Once it's placed in random access memory, then it also gets processed for output for your video. In a nutshell, that's in a nutshell. We'll talk about details in a minute. What I'm trying to tell you is that there are components inside the motherboard that are connected together, which allows the information that you put into the computer to travel from one place to another. That pretty straightforward? And I'll bring a motherboard on Wednesday to give you more detail. All of this to say that computers use electricity to process information. It uses electricity to process information. And it processes the information in a form that we refer to as a binary form, using binary numbers. And a binary number is a numbering system that only uses two numbers, zeros and ones, to interpret a variety of information. Let me erase this for me. So what is the numbering system that we use?
Numerical.
What is the numbering system that we use? It's a 10 base. It's a 10 base or base 10 numbering system, because we use 10 numbers. We use 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and 9. We have been doing this since we were in kindergarten. So it becomes natural to us nowadays to take any of these numbers and create a combination of numbers that have a meaning to us. So for example, I can take the 3, the 4, and the 7, and everybody in this room understands the significance of this combination of numbers. What is it?
347.
Only a few? 347.
347.
It's 347. What is it?
347.
It's 347. You see how easy it comes natural to us. We've been doing this for so long that you can take these numbers. I can take 1, 0, 2, 3, and 4. What's the value?
10,234.
You see? It just comes natural to you. You just know exactly what that combination of numbers means. And we can go to infinity. Using this numbering system, we can go to infinity. You can keep counting until the end of time, and you won't be done using this combination of numbers, this numbering system. Because there are different numbering systems. There is another numbering system referred to as hexadecimal. And a hexadecimal numbering system uses base 16. Okay? The numbers are 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and then it uses letters. A, B, C, D, E, and F. So that if we were to use this numbering system, I could write something like this. What does that mean?
7A.
What does 7A stand for? The A represents the number 10. The A represents the number 10. The B represents the number 11. The C represents the number 12. The D represents the number 13. Excuse me. E represents the number 14. And F represents the number
15.
All right. So I can say, I'm not going to say 710 because that's not what it means, right? It stands 7 and 10. It's two different numbers, okay? 7 and 10. If I'm using a hexadecimal numbering system and I write 3 and 7, this doesn't read 37. If you know that you're using a hexadecimal numbering system, this doesn't read 37. This reads what?
3 and 7.
Exactly. Right. If I write 9F, how does that read? How does that read?
9 and 15.
Exactly. 9 and 15. With computers, we use zeros and ones. Computers use zeros and ones to communicate with each other. And the way it's done is that we have an understanding. So for example, when I give you the combination of 10 numbers from 0 to 9, everybody in this room, I'm not teaching you nothing new. You already know that information. And you will find that in computers, the way computers operate and how they communicate with each other, not only at this level, but even at the networking level, you already have the understanding. You already know the rules of communication. It's just that you need to apply it to how computers operate, if you will. Because when I talked about the numbers from zero to nine, you already have that understanding. You already understand that if you have a combination of numbers from 0 to 9, and if you take the numbers and you combine them together, we have an understanding. I can tell you right now 20,536. Or 65,536, and everybody in this room can visualize what that number means. All right? So with binary numbers, what happens is that if you have two components, if I have a component here and I have another component here, I can connect. And when I say a component, it could be a microchip. These are microchips right here, per se. All right? And the way we're going to connect, let's say we are computer engineers today. We are in charge of inventing the computer. And what we're going to do is we're going to have two devices that are going to connect to each other, and we have to have a way for them to communicate effectively. We also have to allow them to understand a protocol of communication. Remember did I talk last time about uniplex, duplex, and full duplex? That's a protocol of communication. So we can put software in here that will allow this device to understand that it needs to communicate in a certain way with this device. And we're gonna put software in here that will allow this device to understand the communication coming from this device. Not only that, but also send information this direction as well, so that they both can talk to each other. They're gonna do that by using binary numbers. And the way that we can allow this to happen is by connecting these devices using traces or lines. Basically, a metal. We're gonna use a physical metal that will allow the electricity to travel through that metal, if you will, from one device to another. So it's a mechanical device. And we're gonna do that by giving it 8 lines. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Because binary numbers over here, all by themselves, mean nothing. Just that 0 and 1 doesn't really mean anything. You have to have a combination of 8 binary numbers, 4 or 8, depending on who you're talking to. All right? So that in order for it to mean something. So for example, if I have this number right here, Excuse me.
I got in my eye.
So this number right here is what we refer to as a byte. Eight zeros and ones put together are one byte. And in order for a binary number to mean something, you have to have a combination of eight zeros and ones, or you have to have one byte, okay? So that if I'm trying to represent this number, all right? If this device is trying to represent this number to that device, we can do that by placing electricity, maybe if we have an understanding, right? If we create an understanding between this device and that device, that this line right here is gonna be this number right here, that this line right here is gonna be this number right here, and so on and so on and so on and so on. Then I can represent that binary number from this device to that device by placing electricity here. Where's the trash can? Did I make it? No. All right. So I can put electricity right there. So that electricity will travel from this device to that device only on that line. That device is gonna read this number just like that. There's gonna be electricity here, no electricity here. No electricity here, no electricity here, no electricity here, no electricity here. So that when it receives that information, it's only gonna say, oh, there's only electricity on this line. That number represents the number 64. Why? Because each and every one of these binary numbers have a value. They have a value. Check this out. This device and that device understand the value of the position of each number in this fashion. This position, the value is 1. This position, the value is 2. This position, the value is 4. This one is 8. This one is 16. This one is 32. This one is 64. And this one is 128. So that if I have a 0 over here, I'm not gonna take this value as a value of anything because I'm using a 0. If I put a 1 here, check this out. If I write that number over here, I know that that number means the number 64 because the only value that I'm adding is the position of the value that has a 1. So that this number right here, this binary number, represents the number 64. If I change this number to a value of 1, then what is my value now?
65.
65, right? Mm-hmm. Because I'm gonna add this number right here plus this number right here, and not the numbers that have zeros, in order to make sense of it. This represents the number 65. If I wanna write the number 66 in a binary form, then I have 64. I'm not gonna add these values or that one because they have zeros. I'm gonna add that value because that one has a 1. So 64 plus 2 is 66. Is this making any sense?
Starting to finally.
Yes. So if I wanna make the number 68, I can put a 1 here and a 0 here, and it's 64 plus 4 is 68. So you only add the numbers, when I'm looking at binary numbers over here, I only add the numbers, the values of the numbers that have 1 and not the numbers that have zeros. Now, why is this important? Because we have computers and programmers, people who program computers, all right?
Let me see.
People who program computers use a table that we refer to as the ASCII table. What does ASCII stand for?
Visual
write that down, because you're gonna be making a little bit of research after this class to get more in-depth knowledge of what the ASCII table is. The ASCII table is the American Standard Code for Information Interchange. The American Standard Code for Information Interchange. And what that means is that if this device right here wants to say to that device, hey, if this device wants to send the letter A, to that device over there, the letter A is represented in a binary number by the number 65. The number 65, the American Standard Code for Information Interchange says that the number 65 in a binary number means the letter A in our symbols that we understand. So if you press the letter A, for example, on your keyboard, it sends a signal into the computer to please put number A on your Word document that you're typing, right? And in essence, it's sending a binary number 65, to be processed by the CPU, to be placed on random access memory, so that it can be displayed on the monitor for you. So there's a conversion that needs to take place. That's why we use the American Standard Code for Information Interchange, so that computers can relate information to you in a way that you understand, so that they can create a symbol on the screen that you understand. But when you click on the keyboard to send the signal into the computer, it's not gonna use your letter, it's gonna use a binary number, because computers can only communicate in a binary form by placing information on the traces in the different lines that they are connected with. So that the schematic that I drew earlier, where you have input devices putting information into the computer, and then it goes to a microchip, and then to another microchip, and then to another microchip, which we're gonna learn the names of here in the next few days. Information is traveling in this fashion once it goes into the computer, in a binary form, by placing electricity in the different lines, by having an understanding, each one of these devices have an understanding of what the binary number means. Hold on a second, we had a...
So B would be 66 and a C would be 67.
Exactly. And you don't need to know what each binary number means, but I do need you to know how to convert these numbers into this value. Okay? And this is why I want you to play that binary game on that Cisco game, that binary game, because you need to know binary numbers, because computers only communicate in a binary form, okay? And you need to learn, to a certain extent, to speak the language of computers, which is binary. The language of computers is what?
Binary.
Did you have a question or a comment?
Yeah, if you have a value of, say, 256, then it's gonna be 8 ones, and then you need to go with another set of bits, another byte with all zeros, and then one. Is that correct?
No, not necessarily, because this number, the maximum number that you can have is 255.
So what's your number, 256?
There is no number 256, because this right here only represents one symbol. So we have a binary number for this symbol. I don't know what the binary number is. So we only need 9 binary numbers to represent our 9 binary, our 9,
gotcha.
Okay?
Thank you.
So the maximum number that you can have here, if I want to have the maximum number that you can have, would be 255, right? If I put ones over here, then you add these numbers, 128 plus 64 is 192, Let me see, 128 plus 64 is 192, plus 32 is 224, plus 16 is 248, is 240, plus 8 is 248, right? Plus 4 is 252, plus 2 is 254, plus 1 is 255. I can say then, hold on Bryce, I can say that the maximum amount of numbers that I can have here are 256. Why 256? Because if I put zeros here, this is the minimum number that I can have, then my value is zero. So that from zero to 255, there are 256 characters.
Because you start with zero, right?
No matter what we put in here, 1, 0, blah, blah, this is always going to only gonna be considered a byte, though, right?
This is a byte.
Yeah,
right.
So it doesn't matter what we, what the maximum, minimum, it'll always be only one byte. Can we add up bytes?
Exactly, and this is where it gets more exciting, right? Because this device, these two devices right here, are communicating in what we call an 8-bit bus. Because each one of these digits is referred to as a bit. I need 8 bits to get 1 byte. Okay? I need 8 bits to get 1 byte. So the width of this bus, the width of this bus is an 8-bit bus. If I say that the width of this bus is an 8-bit bus, then that means that those two devices are communicating using only 8 lines. However, buses don't communicate like that anymore. This is old school. I only did this to help you understand, you know, the theory behind you. So if I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 15, 16. I have 16 lines over here now. The width of this bus is what?
16.
It's 16 bits. This is a 16-bit bus, meaning that instead of using one byte, it's gonna use 2 bytes to communicate at a time. It's gonna send information from one device to another using 2 bytes. So in essence, I could send, if I have an agreement, that these first 8 bits, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, are 1 byte, and this other 8, another byte, I can send the number 64 by placing electricity here, and the number 65 by placing electricity here, and here. You see that? So that this device understands that there's 2 bytes coming its direction at a time. Isn't it?
We're looking at it downwards. So the first 8 down would be 1 byte, and the second 8 down would be 1 byte.
Right, and it doesn't matter which direction we're looking at, because they have an understanding of how they,
so that,
they communicate.
So that dot that you have there would track them to 1. That could be on any line.
Well, no, I'm saying it doesn't matter to us, but it matters to these devices, right? So if you're this device right here, and I'm this device right here,
right,
you and me better have an understanding that this is 1 byte and this is a second byte, and where it begins and where it ends, so that we can send electricity from one to another faster. And you will be able to understand. I'm saying A and B right there. And you're like, oh, A and B. I don't have to break it down to you when I say house, for example. You know exactly what it means. So if I send you a whole bunch of binary numbers, that device is gonna be able to interpret those binary numbers, know exactly what it means, and it will know exactly what to do with it pretty fast. Because in its programming, it's been programmed to understand that particular language in that particular fashion. Bryce, did you wanna add something?
Well, I'm good.
Okay. Any questions or comments? Okay, who feels confused? It's okay, you can tell me. Bryce, what's confusing about this?
Does it matter if you're running a 32-bit or a 64-bit operating system? As to whether it's a 8-bit or 16-bit?
Right, and this is, you're going way ahead of what I'm trying to cover. But just to answer your question, yes, it matters. It matters, right? This is why we design. Nowadays, we don't really have 16-bit buses. We have 32, right? So there's 32 lines connected from one to another. Or there are 64 lines connected from one to another. Or there are 128 lines or traces. We refer to these, each one of these lines as traces. So if I'm looking at, I think the book has a picture. Maybe. Right, on page number 19, if you brought your book, on page number 19 it's showing the back of a motherboard and the back of the CPU, where the CPU, this device, sits in the back of this, right? And you can see clearly in this picture how there are lines going from one component to another, physical lines that are carrying data or electricity.
I was also wondering, now when you're adding the binary mathematics, do you just add or you add, subtract, multiply, divide, just like you do with regular mathematics?
I'm just adding.
Okay.
I'm just adding.
So,
it's confusing.
Each one of those lines is just one binary number.
That's correct.
Okay. So when it's 16, you go all the way up to 8, and then that's where you lost me. You go all the way up to 8, you don't say you put all zeros and 1 at the end, so it's 1. And then you start over again, I mean, to make it 16. When you did the 8 one, I understood it.
Right.
But now with the 16,
Right, you're dead on. So if I'm sending 2 bytes, it could read something like this. And then,
all right.
So that's what you're reading. You're reading the entire thing at a time. So this is 64. This is 65. And it's coming at you at the same time. So this number represents the letter A, and this number represents the letter B. And they're both coming at you at the same time.
In a 16-bit.
Exactly. In a 16-bit, then now you have 4 characters coming at you at the same time. You see? Right? So and the same thing with 32. I would have 8 characters coming at me at the same time. If you have 64, then you have 16 characters coming at you at the same time. That might have lost some people.
Yeah.
Now, it's not going to try to trick us sometimes when we're doing homework and give us the letters and tell us that we got to come up with the binary.
No, not at all, because I'm not teaching you the ASCII table. If this class was a programming class, if this was the C++ class, then I would be saying, yes, you need to learn the binary value to the binary letter. I don't need you to know that. What I need you to know is that computers communicate in a binary form, and I need you to be able to convert the binary number into a value that we understand. You don't have to necessarily do the conversion. The following step would be to do the conversion using the ASCII table to what its character mean. That's not within the scope of this class. All right, I pointed out the American Standard Code for Information Interchange to say that computers use binary numbers to represent a particular value in a 10-base form, which can be converted using an ASCII table into a symbol that we understand. Hold that thought.
So we're not going to have to use hex and translate it into binary?
Yes, we will, but we're not there yet. We will, but we're not there yet. And I will show you how to do that later. All right? That's why I brought it up earlier. These are hex numbers. And later I'm going to show you how to take a hexadecimal number, convert it into a binary number, and then convert it into a number, a 10-base number. All right? Which then gets converted using the ASCII table into a symbol. So, you know, it's a step-by-step process. Let me show you binary numbers first, because this is, you know, if you really need to, what time is it?
I'm still good.
You really need to get a good grasp on this binary number thing and how computers have devices. Take, for example, this integrated circuitry right here, right? If I look at these microchips, I should pass this around. This is not a motherboard for a computer. this is more for a switch of some kind or a hub, but it's the same principle. The principle is that these devices, microchips, are connected to each other on the surface of the board, because the board is like a city, right? You have a north bridge, you have a south bridge. Actually, you can actually sit like this. Not even a tablet chip. It's not a computer motherboard. But in essence, these devices connect to each other using lines or traces. And those traces represent a particular width or a bus. When you have one individual line, it's referred to as a trace. When you have a group of traces together, like this one right here, we refer to it as a bus. Depending on the number of traces that we have, then we can then say this is an 8-bit bus, a 16-bit bus, a 32-bit bus, a 64-bit bus. When I say that, I am referring to the physical number of traces that carry data. Okay?
So it's not considered a bus until you have at least 8.
It's not considered a bus until you have at least 8, but again, today's buses, we are running 32 bits and up. 32, 64, 128. And in the future, we might move into bigger buses than that, right? We are in a transitional period. And this is true for computers. We've been in a transitional period since day one. It's been evolving and getting better and faster and smaller. I mean, look at us now. Our phones are sophisticated computers. I mean, you talk to any old timer, you know, that had anything to do with computers 20 years ago, and they will tell you that these devices are sophisticated computerized devices that have, you know, in very small integrated circuitries inside with components that communicate in binary numbers and operating systems that allow you to interface with it. Right. Questions or comments?
I just want to know. So, okay, like you said, the 255, it's everything, but the 256 characters, it would make it one more because everything would be one?
No, because the zero counts as one character.
At the end?
In the beginning.
Okay.
So for example, what's your name?
Stan.
Stan, if I remember when I said the 10 base, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, mm-hmm. How many numbers you have there?
You got
10. You got 10 because I start counting from the 0, right? The 0 is one character, the 1 is the second character, the 2 is the third character. The number of characters is not necessarily the value of the character. You see what I'm saying? So the same thing here, right? I start with a 0, and that's my first character, doesn't necessarily have a value, okay? And if I go all the way to 256, my total number of characters is 256 characters, okay? How much time do we got? Not that much, huh? Well, not bad for our first day of class.
Yeah.
It's quite a bit. How about we stop here, because this is a good stopping point. And we'll have 15 minutes to do paperwork and whatever, you know. And I'll see you here Wednesday.
What would be an example of like an 8-bit? Would that be like a 386 or a 4?
Was that right?
An 8-bit would be like a 386 or a 4.
I just gotta get my news in a
cap. Well, they were, yeah, right. They were more like 8 and 60 bits. 8 and 60 bits.
Crap.